This talk, I'm going to read a little bit, but also mostly talking about the pictures that I, the slides that I will be showing you. This is part of a larger research project I have been exploring for the past couple of years. In the larger project, I analyze the way specific kinds of refugees, I call them refugees with cultural capital, which means they are not the poor refugees that people that come to mind when we talk about refugees, and upper and middle class Jordanian women who are changing the physical landscape of Amman and its cultural map.
Okay, so I use cultural anthropology, I'm a cultural anthropologist, to understand the Amman art scene that's emerging in relation to regional conflicts in Syria, Iraq, and before in Palestine, and the war in the return of the Jordanian Palestinians from Kuwait in 1990, neoliberal policies that have been implemented by the state, gender roles, and the way they change the urban environment. Okay, so this is a map of, I tried to construct a map of refugees in Amman. So the first group of refugees, I'm not going to go that deep in the history, is Sherkes, the Circassians, who came in late 19th century, and they are known to be the ones who settled Amman as the first group. Then, of course, the influx of Palestinian refugees after 1948 and after 1967, where thousands and thousands of them came to Jordan, but the large majority of them lived in cities, mostly in Amman and around it. Then we move to 1970s to 1990s, it's the civil war in Lebanon. Some came, but not actual refugees, but mostly investment in Jordan because of the war in Lebanon. Then we move here to from Kuwait. After the Saddam invaded Kuwait, thousands of Palestinians and Jordanians returned to Amman, to Jordan mostly. They mostly lived in Amman. And then the Iraq wars, both of them, the US invasion of Iraq in 1990, large number of Iraqis started to come to Jordan. And of course, after 2003, where more and more of them came in. And the last wave of refugees in after 2011 from Syria, and it's still going on. So I will be going back to this to talk about this, these waves of refugees and the way they are shaping the cultural landscape. So how do we explain the, like if you are familiar with certain areas of Amman today, I will be focusing on two neighborhoods, Jabal al-Weibdeh and the First Circle. I'm sure some of you or the majority of you have been there. If not, it's worth a visit. The recent changes in Amman's cultural scene, such as the sudden increase in the number of cafes, cultural institutions, art galleries in two specific neighborhoods, Jabal al-Weibdeh and Jabal Amman, mostly the First Circle. This can be understood in relationship to the violent conflict and refugee flows in the Middle East region, along with the implementation of these new liberal policies that I will be explaining later. At the same time, a striking feature of the boom in Amman's art and culture is that most projects, most of these art and cultural projects involve women at their center, who are influencing the transformations in the city's landscape in unprecedented ways. I'm sure some of you recognize this slide. So my encounter and my story and my relationship to, in anthropology, we like to do the reflexive anthropology a little bit and talk about our relationship to the site. So my encounter with Amman as an anthropologist began in early 1990s when I was an anthropology student at Yarmouk University in Irbid. At that time, I conducted field work in the poor neighborhoods of Amman, of East Amman. So I was part of this a larger research group that worked in East Amman. I explored in my that project, I explored the conditions of women and children among the city's squatters and the ways they identified themselves according to their places of origin, either from villages in Palestine or other parts of Jordan. So if you look at these descriptions, what kind of city is this? This is Amman, okay? At that time, my experience of the city aligned with its reputation in the region. It's relatively sleepy. there were no Ammanis, and there was no obvious there was an obvious lack of cultural activities like those in neighboring cosmopolitan centers such as Cairo, Damascus, and Beirut. So every time you talk to someone, it's like, oh, Amman is not Beirut. So this is how it was described. So for then I went to the United States to do my PhD. So for my PhD dissertation, I returned to the region to carry out field work about still about urbanism, but this time I chose Beirut. I researched the ways the post-war conditions and the neoliberal policies implemented by Rafiq al-Hariri and his solidarity project of rebuilding Beirut Central District, the way this project interrupted the lives of ordinary people and ultimately resulted in the decline of cultural activities in Beirut. So people who love Amman might like this. So I concluded that those neoliberal policies diminished Beirut's role as a major regional cosmopolitan center or the reputation of the city as the Paris of the Middle East, because the large neoliberal projects basically destroyed the networks and the relationships of, like, that people developed over the years, and especially the art scene. This is different in Amman. In Beirut, there is a decline because of the neoliberal policies, decline in culture and art. In Amman, it's a different story. When I returned in 2006 to Amman for a new field work project, I was not thinking of working on art, to be honest. I didn't know that Amman has that much art to sustain a research project. At that time, I noticed a striking development. There were strings of contemporary galleries, large-scale projects related to art and crafts, and a strong presence of women as key agents in these processes. The city in general felt more lively. At the same time, its demographics and map were drastically changing. So for the first time, even a group of young women and men started to identify themselves as Ammanis. I don't know if you know any of these Ammanis, but there is a group of people who identify themselves as Ammanis. I was shocked by that. Here I have to note that unlike Beirut in Amman, the regional and political conflicts, wars, and neoliberal policies are having different consequences on the city's artistic and cultural scape. One can argue that these policies are indirectly allowing Amman to emerge as a regional player in culture and art. So it's not that those who implemented the neoliberal policies wanted Amman to emerge as an art center, but it's an indirect consequence of these neoliberal policies and the political conditions in the whole region. Until recently, art circulation in Jordan has been very limited, and it was limited to few venues. Like before 2000, there was a National Art Museum, which is Jordan National Gallery of Fine Arts, an independent foundation, Dar al-Funun, and a few commercial galleries, and three European cultural centers. And that's it. Since the 2000s, however, Amman's arts landscapes has been transformed dramatically. Now there is a sudden increase in the number of art galleries. There are more than 25 art galleries in Amman that are recognized. The circulation of art objects and the organizing of art-related activities. The last one that Barbara just mentioned, which is the Amman, the Design Week. This sudden rise of art scene has a number of effects on the urban landscapes and the experiences of cities' residents. The events in Amman speak to transformations in other cities in and beyond the Middle East. So this is not, like, Amman has a unique experience, but also this experience is shared with other cities. In order to understand the reasons that allowed Amman to emerge as a regional hub for art and culture, I have to situate this city in relationship to anthropological writings about Jordan, urbanism, and the anthropology of art and gender and in the Middle East context. So if we look at the anthropological and social science writings about Jordan, try to think of, on the top of your head, about the topics that mostly anthropologists or social scientists look at when they study Jordan. Definitely not art. Anthropological and other social science writings about Amman compared to studies of neighboring capitals are relatively small. This can be explained by the fact that urban scholars have tended to study more historically prominent urban centers in the Middle East. When anthropologists have written about Jordan, the majority have looked past city life. These studies highlighted the country's tribal structure, the tribe and state relationship, focusing more on men. Other anthropologists have also, in addition to studying tribal communities, other anthropologists have documented the experiences of refugee communities in Jordan, particularly the Palestinian refugees, the majority of whom do live in urban areas, as I mentioned earlier. But these studies, including my own studies before, highlighted the urban, but these studies did not specifically highlight the urban qualities of refugee lives. They have focused instead on issues of national identity, the way these refugees identify themselves and maintain their identity, and their relationship to other communities and their relationship to the state. However, I'm not undermining, of course, these studies. These are important. A few ethnographies also centered on ethnic minorities in Jordan. For example, the work of Setani Shami about Circassians, and some have also examined the conditions of the working class in East Amman, but about like the conditions of poverty and survival strategies. After the US invasion of Iraq and the eruption of civil war in Syria, also it triggered an influx of this, almost 2 million refugees came to Jordan. This prompted anthropologists who worked on refugees also to document the experiences of the most recent refugees. As anthropology in general turned its attention to women and gender, a few studies highlighted the conditions and the role of women in the conditions of refugees in East Amman or among the Syrian and Iraqi refugees. One recent study is by Fida Adeli, who also, I think she was at ACOR last year or 2 years ago. Also, she examined the conditions of women and education, but without focusing on the urban surrounding. Reviewing these writings, it is evident that anthropologists working on Jordan have tended to write about the tribal structure, oppressed groups such as refugees, minorities, and women, especially in the working class. While these studies offer valuable analysis of these topics, those frameworks do not capture the urban experiences of Jordan's population, and they don't capture the role of upper and middle class women in reshaping the urban landscapes. There is one exception with a comparative study that compared the art landscape in Amman with that of Morocco, Paris, and Detroit, and then compared it to Amman. That's a short study. Other than that, there is nothing. But I'm glad it exists. So before what people label as the Arab Spring, and in the past 10 years, anthropologists alongside geographers generated a body of sophisticated writing about cities and urban transformation in Arabs, in other Arab cities such as Beirut, Cairo, Dubai, and Damascus. These and related studies have incorporated frameworks of urbanism, globalization, cosmopolitanism, and the effects of neoliberal policies on the lives of city dwellers. Some ethnographies have applied this framework to the case of young adults. For example, the work of Sufyan Rabit on Beirut, where he describes the role of global urban public spaces in the formation of queer culture in Beirut. Similarly, sociologist Mona Abaza wrote about the consumption patterns of the privileged youth in Cairo who shop at malls and frequent Western cafes. And there is another study about young men who drive in a careless way in Riyadh in Saudi Arabia, and there is an analysis of that. It's an interesting one. And there is a study about Tunisia, about who like the author explained how cosmopolitanism reshape the relationships between what he named local hugglers in the market and the European tourists. So these studies are new studies emerging about cosmopolitanism, globalization in urban cities in the Middle East. They anchor my work about Amman because I have to put my work in a larger context. So these are the studies that are similar in scope. Although anthropologists did not study Amman and its urban culture, in the past few years, however, significant writings about Amman came from political scientists who are concerned with the neoliberal agendas as they filtered through municipal policies and a documentation of the Abdali project. Like some political scientists wrote about that. And the work of urban planner Rami Daher and geographer Maryam Ababsa also are good examples of those who wrote and responded to the transformations in Amman from the changes in the population to the changes of the urban landscapes. So these are also, alongside the writings about other Arab cities, these are important works that one should look at when studying Amman. The other framework that I try to situate my material with is the anthropology of art. If you are familiar with the history of anthropology, art is not new to anthropologists. Anthropologists started to explore different forms of art produced by small-scale communities since the early 1900s. Anthropologists documented the ways art objects were used in rituals, such as masks, body adornment, and the way people decorated their places of residence. For example, they describe him as the father of anthropology. Franz Powers studied the indigenous art of Native Americans and published a book entitled Primitive Art, and that was in 1927. Of course, we don't use the word primitive now, just for the record. Some anthropologists started to question the reasons for not studying Western contemporary art only in the 1990s. So anthropologists were studying tribal art, primitive art, art of other communities, but they didn't study Western art, even if it was produced in non-Western communities. However, with the spread of postmodern theories and all of this, some anthropologists started to question, like, why don't we study the avant-garde communities? Why don't we study Western art as culture, as artifacts? So there was a few, like there is a great edited volume by Marcus Fisher and Fred Meyer, where they really collected articles questioning the reasons for not studying Western art. And also this came at a time when anthropology also started to question the way museums in the West display artifacts. For example, if you walk at the Met, I have to bring something from New York, you have the section on Western art, and that's, you will see paintings, you see artworks, and there is a little bit of a description of the piece, and there is a description of a name of the artist. If you go to the non-Western sections, you don't see that. Like there's artifacts coming from a basket from this place or that place, or a mask made by this indigenous population or that indigenous population. So anthropologists started to question these things. It's like, why don't we have names of the people who made these artifacts or slash art? So there was a time when this was debated. So George Marcus and Fred Myers, they called for a new relationship of anthropology to the study of art. They called for a model that is different from just mediating non-Western objects and aesthetics to Western audiences, because that's what anthropologists do. They describe non-Western societies for Western audiences. Instead, they called for studies that engage Western art worlds themselves, casting a critical light on the mediation itself, and proposes a renegotiation of the relationship between art and anthropology. So still anthropologists didn't study Western art in non-Western societies. There is one exception, one study about the art scene in Cairo by Jessica Winiger, who's an anthropologist also, and she looked at art, like, trained Egyptian artists and the way they negotiate their art with different political policies. A few sociologists, unlike anthropologists, sociologists studied art, and they have explored the ways the art throws in tandem with gentrification. And I will be talking about gentrification. I don't know if you are familiar with gentrification. It's not a neutral word, especially in Western cities such as New York, London, Berlin, and Toronto. There is a book by Sharon Zukin. It's called Loft Living. It was published in 1983. It's one of the earliest studies on the topic of urbanism and art. The author investigated the connections between art, cultural capital, and the market in a post-industrial New York City neighborhood. The name of the neighborhood is Soho. Some people might not know it. Zukin presented the ways in which middle-class artists managed to foster an avant-garde community in the decaying parts of New York City. Efforts ironically helped lead to the gentrification that ultimately priced most of those artists out of the neighborhood. The reason I'm mentioning this, it's not because I want to talk about New York, because I'm going to talk about a case study later on where I gave a talk about gentrification in Amman and the reaction that I got from the artists about that. Coverage of the Global South, in contrast, has examined these themes in not so intensively. Okay, another easy topic to deal with, gender in the Middle East. I'm joking, it's not easy. Today, I bring an urban-centered framework of analysis that highlights women as I examine the role played by upper and middle-class women in the formation of the cultural scene in Amman. So, the topic of women has been slower to incorporate this urban political economy framework. Generally speaking, the main approach to studying gender in the Arab and Middle East cities, if you look at the library here, you can see this, or any library, they tend to center on the experiences of particular women. Earlier studies centered on underprivileged, uneducated, veiled women who are oppressed by the patriarchal institution of religion and family. There is no shortage of those studies. However, some recent scholarship started to criticize these tendencies, as for example the work of Leila Boulud, Farhan Ghannam, and all of these people. They criticize these traditional studies, and they challenge the older model by focusing on women's agency. So women, although they are oppressed, all of this, uneducated, and all of this, they have some agency. So there are some new studies that focus on this. But still, there has been little attention paid to secular, educated, upper and middle class women. So even with scholars who criticize the older model, like for example, they look at women and religion and like there is agency there, or they look at like for example, the group Saba Mahmoud calls it the mosque movement in Cairo. So, but nobody, like for some reason, there is an avoidance of addressing secular and upper and middle class women. I'm not saying that everybody should be studying them, but we should look at them, especially in relationship to their participation in public life and in reshaping the urban space. Women professionals in Amman not only navigate the existing urban space, they have been also reshaping specific parts of the city and establishing intra-regional connections for the flow of culture through art and art galleries. My analysis of the role of these women in reshaping the urban public sphere in Amman has been informed by feminist geographers' writings on space who worked mostly outside the Middle East. These studies have questioned the framework of the public, private, men are in the in public sphere and women are in private sphere, and there is no crossing between the two. Other social scientists in the Arab world started also, especially feminist writers, started to question the dichotomy of the public and private. For example, the work of Sondra Hale and Suad Joseph and people like that. These frameworks focus on urban space that consider the intersection of class, gender, and other social variables that provide a background for my consideration of the art scene in Amman. Have you seen this? It's a fascinating piece. How can we use anthropology, after looking at all of these theoretical frameworks of looking at culture and cities, how can we use anthropology to study Amman's art scene? So if you look at this map, I don't know who made it, but it's called the Creative Trail in Jabal al-Weibdeh. And this is even better. There are always English and Arabic, and be creative, and okay, so now it tells us it's the Tahad al-Arabi, the European Union, sponsored this creative trail in Jabal al-Weibdeh. So I'm not going to, so in order to understand what's happening in Amman, I have to look at, I'm not going to look at all the history of immigration to the city, the one I described earlier. I will only look at three waves of immigrants or refugees who came to Amman. The first one is the 1990s after the Iraq invasion of Kuwait, and then the U.S. invasion of Iraq also in the early 1990s. And the imposition of the, and more refugees came to Jordan after the UN sanctions on Iraq. So why is it important to look at the experiences and the presence of Iraqi refugees, in fact, more than Syrian refugees? The Jordanian government didn't consider Iraqis as refugees. I don't know if you are aware of this. They describe them as guests, the guests of Jordan. And one of the things, one of these policies that really shaped a lot of what I'm working on now is that they implemented a law that if an Iraqi family or an Iraqi, they can invest $150,000 in Jordan, they can get a residency permit and qualify for the privileges of citizens in Jordan. So this affected so many things in Jordan. The first thing is, there is a flow of money. Suddenly there is a big flow of money in the country. Second, which is really important, that's why that explains the emergence of Weibdeh and Rainbow Street and these areas as new areas, because the prices of properties in West Amman escalated so much. And I'm sure if you lived in Amman, you know that the prices of property went very high, which means people who grew up in West Amman, suddenly like their families are there, they cannot afford to buy properties there, or to, especially if you are a young person. So what happens is because of these circumstances, also there was an upper and middle class emerging in Amman, and these are people who mostly studied either in the West and returned to Amman, or they received a kind of Western education in the city. This means that they didn't go to public schools. And also there was a cheaper, relatively cheaper, traditional Amman homes in older neighborhoods. So I don't call, it's really interesting because do we call Weibdeh and Jabal Amman Third Circle as East Amman? Yes and no. We can call them East Amman because at one point there was lower middle class and working class people living in these areas. But the history of those areas is different from, like, for example, other parts of the city. So one has to take this into consideration when we look at this. For example, in 2010, it was estimated that 15% of Jordan's population was Iraqi, which is a lot of presence of Iraqis. Of course, in addition to the Iraqi refugees, and as a result of the war in Syria, more than 1.5 million Syrians sought refuge in Jordan, many of whom moved to live in Amman and the surrounding areas. These waves of war-driven refugees do not only enlarge the population, but also trigger changes in the city and in several ways. As a result of Jordan's stipulations, the displaced Iraqi included a sizable proportion of upper and middle class people who had access to both material and cultural capital, and this is what I mentioned earlier on. So the economic and cultural capital of those refugees had resulted in remarkable transformations to other aspects of the city landscape. Among these refugees were a number of well-established artists who brought past work and their ongoing artistic practice to the city that was in other ways ready to expand its cultural dimension. And it's really interesting to know here because even like in the early 1990s, for example, until then, Jordan University didn't have an arts department. The only arts department was at Yarmouk. And at suddenly there were lots of faculty members who are teaching art at Yarmouk in the early 1990s. The presence of a Jordanian urban educated population also interested in art as art producers, but also as consumers of art, coincided with the influx of Iraqi artists and intellectuals and the sudden rise of the prices of property in Amman. The city suddenly gave rise to an unprecedented flurry of intellectual activities, social networks, and the creation of new art spaces, as well as major transformations in the actual physical landscape of some city neighborhoods. These drastic changes boosted the city's position in the region's circulation of contemporary art. Whereas before the Iraq War in 2003, Amman was home only to the three galleries that I mentioned before. If we look at the map of the art galleries in Amman, it's really interesting to find that the majority, in fact, almost all of them, are run by women who had not been visible in civil society or especially markets. Like you don't see, if you go to the downtown area, you don't see women selling anything in the markets, maybe at the malls. But so now the upper and middle class women, they are selling art to the public, so which really also challenges the dichotomy of the public and private. Art galleries in Amman are clustered both in the affluent West Amman and the other parts of the city, especially in Weibdeh and Jabal Amman. In West Amman, galleries are newly constructed housed in newly constructed villas amid upscale shops and homes. My focus here, at least today, would be in Old Amman, specifically the neighborhoods, these two neighborhoods. In these districts, neighboring crowd, like if you walk in Weibdeh, like off on the street where Dar al-Funun and Dar al-Anda are located, you will see craft shops, small grocery stores, mosques, and kids playing in the streets. The galleries and arts organization are being created in the middle of this traditional working class landscape. So in Jabal Amman, and this is the picture is of a gallery in Jabal Amman, is a recently revived old neighborhood located above the downtown area. Historically, Jabal Amman used to be one of the city's prominent districts where the affluent families of the city resided. And I'm sure you know some of the names of those prominent families who own some homes in Jabal Amman, but most of them are empty. One can still see in the remaining well-constructed old houses, the area started to decline in the 1970s as the city started to expand westward. In the early 2000s, Jabal Amman started to attract some of West Ammani residents, especially Rainbow Street. And it's interesting, if you know the story of Rainbow Street, that was the old name, it's Rainbow Street. When the municipality changed the names of streets, they gave it a name of one of those names that nobody remembers, recognizes. But then they changed it back to Rainbow, which is really interesting. Rainbow Street is one of the busiest streets in the area. It is dotted with new restaurants, cafes, shops, and some cultural institutions, such as the British Council, the River Jordan Foundation. In the past few years, Rainbow Street and areas around it became a favorite location for strolling, shopping, and dining. In the smaller streets off Rainbow Street, a number of Ammani homes have been renovated into cultural centers, such as the ecological non-for-profit Wild Jordan, the Royal Films Center, and many other attractive organizations. Other buildings nearby also house some of the new art galleries, such as Wadi Finan and Nabat Galleries, that I will be talking about briefly. Although these renovated structures blend with the surrounding buildings, the arts neighborhoods exude polished and tourist-ready quality. First Circle seems deliberately planned, if not coordinated, as the district develops, gentrifies, and becomes one of the few renowned night spots for locals, expats, and tourists alike. So, and people who continue to live there, they don't like that. They decided. So this is an image of the east-west, and that's another gallery house, also Wadi Finan, which is in Jabal Amman. Also, it's a house in an old house. So these galleries, they represent a number of artists, the majority of whom are Iraqi. So when I looked at their website, you will find like a gallery would have 30 artists that they represent. There will be at least 22 Iraqi artists, 3 Jordanians, 1 Egyptian, 1 Lebanese, 1 Sudanese. This is the typical map of the artists that they represent. In an interview with one of the founders of the Nabat Gallery, the co-owner told me that she views the Iraqi art as an asset to the Jordanian art scene. She said the influx of Iraqi art in Amman's galleries challenged Jordanian artists and forced many of them to produce better quality art. And I heard this from more than one gallery owner. So these are just images of some of the art organizations that are in Weibdeh and Jabal Amman. So Dar al-Funun, I'm sure some of you recognize this view. And it is it's one of the old one of the oldest art galleries in Amman. So it was there before refugee artists and Iraqi artists started to come. So also it is in a renovated old home. So these are some of their galleries, and you can see that with the tiles and with the walls and all of that. This is one of the buildings from the outside. The second art gallery is another one also. It's in Weibdeh, very close to Dar al-Funun. This is an old one. They changed the color now. I think this one is prettier. And also Dar al-Anda, it's also in an old house that was built in 1920s. And the owner of the gallery, she renovated it and next other buildings to it. And so this is Dar al-Anda. So it's very similar even from the inside to some of the gallery halls of Dar al-Funun. And this is the gallery from the outside, and also you can see the connection and the relationship to the old cities and the view of old Amman. So this the emergence of art also. So although it's happening on these private galleries and non-for-profit organizations, but also it encouraged other artists and younger artists to do street art. So I'm not talking about just graffiti to express anger, which is the history of graffiti at least in New York City. This is like a kind of beautifying Amman, and there are also some non-for-profit organizations that are working to do this. Like if you walk in Weibdeh, all the stairs are painted. These are not really hanging plants. These are paintings of hanging plants on the walls. So they took, you might think they are plants. They are only painted plants on the walls, or a mixture of both. They even do the shadow of it. This is another also so the art scene has also encouraged other institutions to emerge in the area. This is a restaurant in also in Weibdeh. There are lots of stairs upstairs and downstairs, and they are incorporating the stairs into the culture of the city. So this is a restaurant. It's called Saqit al-Darawish. And even when they did the place, they put a call on Facebook for younger people in Amman to come and help them paint. So it was painted by although it's a private restaurant, it's like college students and teenagers who painted the pots to have the flowers and to have the plants, and they painted also the sidewalk and the stairs. So this is one of my critique of this whole Amman art scene. So the gap between the very rich and the very poor is growing. Although I'm saying that we should study the upper and middle class, but also we cannot study the upper class without looking at other classes. So once I went with this group to discover Jabal al-Qala, which is really interesting. This is how they describe it. Go and discover Jabal al-Qala or discover downtown Amman, and it's really it shows the class hierarchy. So they go there, they t-
teach the kids to fly kites, although these kids do that anyway. So there are some problems with them as being, and that's the point that I mentioned before, being gentrifiers. And this takes me to, okay, so this is another set of stairs, painting it as a carpet, and this is in Weibdeh. And this is the group, it's called Hamzat Wasil, which is, it's a letter in Arabic, but also it's a connection, if you don't, if you look at the meaning of it. So they go and work with the kids and try to do things in poor neighborhoods. This is a gallery also in Weibdeh. It's called McCann Gallery. Good luck trying to find it. If you go ask people, where is McCann? Wayne McCann. It's like, which McCann do you want? This means, because McCann means space. With McCann Gallery, one of the things that took place there in 2014, I was invited to give, they had a group there, they had some activities, and they invited speakers to give talks about Amman and about the art scene. And it's called, the group called T-Jasad. So they are playing also on the Arabic and English, the T in English, and the word Jasad, which means T-body, and which means T-Jasad. To create something. So they invited me to be one of the speakers, so I gave two talks. One of them was on the rooftop, and someone from here attended it 2 years ago. And that talk was about, I negotiated with them about the topic, so I decided to give them to give a talk about the right to the city, which is a movement it started in New York City and Toronto, where the Occupy Wall Street, people who went and did the Occupy Wall Street, that's where the movement started to come. So I gave something about the right to the city, who has the right to the city in this group. And it was very interesting. They were very engaged in learning about it. The talk was in English, of course, as in many of those places. However, later on, I was invited, the day after, I was invited to have a conversation with what they described the gentrifiers of Amman, and that was the most interesting fieldwork experience for an anthropologist. So they invited mostly, they were all women in fact, 14 people who were engaged in the art scene in Amman and the transforming the neighborhood. And we had an informal conversation and informal discussion. So I gave something about the gentrification of New York City that I have been following and working with. So, and I tried to see if there is a similarities between what's going on in Amman in the gentrification process and in connected to the New York experiences. It was really interesting because when we sat to talk about it, we tried, the conversation was supposed to be in Arabic. So we spent at least 20 minutes trying to translate the word gentrification. There is no translation. If you can come up with a translation for the word gentrification, please let me know. It's not development, it's not tanmiya, it's not tahsin or tatweer. It's gentrification, it's really coming from. But everybody knew the word gentrification, and then we agreed that we will just use the word al-gentrification and keep going. Which worked. So when the crowd who came there, they were really interested in learning about the gentrification, and they were, unlike the gentrifiers in New York City, they feel, they know, they are aware, which was really surprising, they are very well aware of the consequences of gentrification. And by gentrification, if you don't know the meaning of gentrification, is when upper and middle class individuals start living in poor neighborhoods or working class neighborhoods and changing those neighborhoods for the people who live in those areas so they can't afford them anymore. So the gentrifiers of Amman who came, and they came identifying themselves as the gentrifiers of Amman and talked about it, and it was really an engaging conversation because most of them wanted to do something to make their presence, at least in Weibdeh, because we were sitting in Weibdeh, to make their presence less harmful to the surrounding, which is really appreciated. But one point that came up from talking to these young individuals is that for women to be able to go into working class neighborhoods, they need a little bit of gentrification. And I'm sure women in this room might sympathize with this. If you walk into, and like, if you dress differently from the working class, if you're not wearing the veil mostly, and you walk into a working class, you are screaming, I'm different. So they wanted some kind of like other gentrifiers with them so they will blend in a little bit. And some of them, they made the point that, including the director of McCann Gallery, which they invite people from the neighborhood to come attend functions and activities. So although the space is gone, but I think these discussions and these debates are shaping the way people talk about the city and the way that they develop a relationship to the city. And these are the people I know it's very problematic for some of you, who identify as Ammanis. So I hope I gave you like a larger, like a framework of what of my research project. Of course, I'm working on other areas. I'm working on art galleries in West Amman. I'm looking at also the way the downtown area is being connected with all of these art institutions in the city. So to conclude, I had to read my conclusion from here. Although Amman has been transformed by regional violence that resulted in the arrival of more than 2 million refugees and the implementation of